Hey, y'all. I'm in between projects here at Chaos Central and decided I had a couple of minutes I could make a quick video, kind of a tips and tricks video here. I know this is, my lighting is bad, my audio is bad. Please forgive the pitter-patter of rain on the roof of the shed, but it's wintertime here in Oregon and it's just a fact of life. I'll do the best I can. A question I keep seeing coming up over and over again in some of the beginners Facebook groups and in some of the other Facebook groups I'm a member of has to do with how much of a bit's shank should go into the collet on the spindle or router. And for some, this may be simple. For others, this may be a little bit more complex. So I figured I'd take a couple of minutes. We'll zoom in here real close and I'll show you what I'm talking about.
So I have a selection of bits here, and I'm going to kind of walk you through some of these. Now, here is a standard downcut spiral, quarter-inch downcut spiral bit in my quarter-inch collet. And again, I can tell that it's a downcut spiral because the cutting edge is on the bottom of the spiral. But if you look in here at how much of the shank I have in the collet, you can see that the cutting edge stops roughly an eighth of an inch away from going into the collet itself. Now, if I flip it over this way, we can see how much of that shank is buried inside that collet. That's going to give me good, sturdy mounting there. Again, we want to get as much of that solid shank up into the collet as possible without that cutting edge slipping into the collet itself. Now, on these smaller bits, in like my eighth inch collet here, that's not always possible. Some of these have this little collar here, and some don't. And if we look up here, if this will focus, there we go, we can see that the cutting edge slips into that little collar. That's fine. This collar is pressed on at the factory, and what we want to do is bury all of that shank down inside this eighth inch collet. Now, if I flip it up here, we can see it doesn't go all the way up in there. There's a bit of a recess, but there's enough of the collet buried, enough of the bit buried in the collet to where that taper is going to grip that shank. Personally, I'd like it if there was a little bit more of the shank up in that collet, but I've been using these for a couple of years, and I've never had one slip on me or break or anything like that. Now, some folks will tell you that these collars here are pressed a specific distance down the shank of the bit so that you don't have to reset your zero after a bit change. And I disagree with that statement. The only evidence I have to support my disagreement is if you look at this pack of 10 bits, you can see that the amount of bit exposed past this collar varies. They're not all standardized. So just my opinion here, I don't care if it's got a collar or not. I'm resetting my Z0 after a bit change. It's just not worth messing around. Okay, so that's on a straight shank or spiral bit. When you get into bits like this V bit, or an extreme example is this, it's a straight mortising bit that I use for surfacing my spoil board. We have a little bit different situation. I'm going to try to get this to focus in on this, and we'll see. If you look at where that shank meets this big orange cutter head here, you'll see that there's a bit of a radius. It's not a straight shank that ends flat against the underside of this cutter. There are no 90 degree angles there. And they do that because a 90 degree angle here, a straight 90 degree, would open up the possibility of stress fractures. And you don't want this cutter head breaking free of the shank at somewhere between 10 and 20,000 RPM. That could really get exciting real fast. So there's a bit of a radius here. That's what I'm getting at. And if you look at this big mortising bit, it's even more exaggerated, but you can certainly see that there's that radius there. What we want to do when we're using a bit like this, come on, there we go, is we want to go ahead and try to bury as much in the collet as we can get, but then back it out about an eighth of an inch, 3 millimeters for those of you who insist on using the French system. Back it out of there so that that radius is not up here in the collet. Because if that's buried all the way in there and you tighten that collet into the router or spindle, the jaws of the collet are grabbing hold of that radius. And after just a few seconds, that bit's going to slip out this way because that's not enough. There's not enough meat there for the collet to grab hold of. So on a bit where you have a solid shank and then it meets a larger cutter head, I slip it all the way in, back it out about an eighth of an inch, 3 millimeters, something to that, you know, something in that range. Now this becomes a little bit more complicated if you use a touch plate to set your Z0. And like me, you don't have a router or spindle that's grounded, and you have to use an alligator clip to ground the bit for use with the touch plate. What I'll do is I'll go ahead and I will clip that alligator clip on there so it's nice and secure, and slip it up into the router like so, and then tighten it up in the router so that I know I have a good solid connection there with my alligator clip, and I have enough of the router shank buried in the collet. Again, don't slip it all the way in there. That's a mistake. You know, the collet doesn't have, there's not enough meat here for that collet to grab hold of if it's buried all the way to that radius. So slip it in, back it out about an eighth of an inch, then you can tighten it up.
So that's basically it. Without overstating it or getting too repetitious, the main thing to remember is to bury as much of that shank of that bit as you can into the collet without either snugging up on that radius or without putting a cutting edge up into the collet itself. So if you got anything at all out of this video, I do hope you'll give me a thumbs up down below. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave them down in the comment section. That's what it's for, y'all. If you'd rather not leave a public comment or you have a question on something else, head on over to my website, marklindseycnc.com, and send me a private message. But I do ask that you please include a valid email address and double check it, please. Here lately, I've been getting quite a few emails through that contact us link that has a problem with the email address. So if you've sent me a comment and I haven't responded to you at all, please send it again. I've gotten a few bounce back that the email address was not valid. So if you want to continue to follow along with the projects I'm doing out here on my Gatton CNC here in the shed, I do hope you'll subscribe to my channel. And if you do, hit that little bell button next to it. That way you'll be notified the next time I decide to go ahead and just post a video for no apparent reason. Like this one. So, whether you subscribe to my channel or not, again, I'd like to thank you very much for watching. Y'all take care.